Please welcome to the stage Carolyn White, shareholder, Brownstein Hyatt, Farber Schreck.
Good morning, everyone. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Amy Liu. Now, you probably all know that Amy is a senior fellow at the Brookings Institution and co-director of the Metropolitan Policy Program there, and a distinguished thought leader and author. I'm not sure exactly what a senior fellow does, but judging from her digital presence, she spends a great deal of her time doing exactly what she's doing here today with us, traveling around the country and the globe, sharing her immense knowledge with communities to help them take these strategies and ideas to build their own community. Last night, I watched several YouTube videos of our keynote speaker, talking to audiences about engaging on a global level, creating high-quality economic growth and opportunity. In just the last couple months, if I'm reading the chronology right, she has presented this information in New Orleans, Phoenix, Louisville, Alexandria, Virginia, and Washington, D.C., just to name a few. Now, what you probably don't know, and according to her Twitter feed anyway, is that it appears that Amy also appreciates a good microbrew. So, Amy, I'd like to share with you that Colorado has 161 microbreweries and brew pubs, which creates some direct 5,000 jobs and another 22,000 indirect jobs in related industries, in wholesaling, retailing, etc. And in case anyone thinks that beer is not important in creating community, I'd like to point you to Chapter 3 in the Metropolitan Revolution book, in which the authors Bruce Katz and Jennifer Bradley note a critical turning point in the transformation of the Denver metro area from a series of competing individual municipalities to an organized, collaborative, networking, regional area happened over steaks and beer in an Adams County restaurant when they negotiated the deal for DIA, for what ultimately became the Denver International Airport. So I commend that book to you, and in particular, Chapter 3. It's a really nice summary of Denver's transformation along the lines of some of the things we'll be talking about with our speakers today. I'm really proud to be part of a firm that, since it was founded by partners Steve Farber, Jack Hyatt, and Norm Brownstein in 1968, has recognized the importance of community and networks. Across the business, government, and nonprofit sectors, 40 years later, in 14 offices in 5 different states, you'll find our lawyers on community boards, task forces, chambers of commerce, and economic development organizations. On behalf of Brownstein, Hyatt, Farber, Schreck, we thank the EDCC for this opportunity to participate in this dialogue. And now, to share with us her ideas about how to drive, lead, succeed, please help me welcome Amy Liu.
Carolyn is right. My family and I are an investor in one of the newest craft breweries in Northern Virginia. And it's been in production for about 3 years, and already last year it won 4 prizes at the Great American Brew Fest here in Denver, Colorado. So I share this region's passion for good craft beer. Well, it's a real pleasure to be here this morning, and I see that the title of my talk is about unleashing the Metropolitan Revolution. And it's a provocative title, again, authored by Bruce Katz, who's my colleague and co-founder at the Brookings Metropolitan Program. And the premise of the book is simple. With Washington broken, it will be cities and metro areas that will address the seismic issues of our times. Well, the seismic issues of our times is the state of the economy and the extent to which the vast majority of working America is actually benefiting from it. I would argue that that should be the objective of economic development leaders and professionals today. To grow not just more jobs and better jobs, but to increase the incomes and opportunities of the citizens in our communities. What is the point of job growth if it is not increasing the quality of life and the incomes of our people. So my goal this morning is to challenge you to push the field of economic development to new heights that will unleash economic growth and opportunities in your communities. Now, as stewards of the economy, it's important to start with a quick look of the economic picture nationally. Now, on the surface, the economy has officially recovered in that the U.S. has regained all the jobs lost in the Great Recession. But our work is not done. Now, in the aftermath of the recession, we are left with three structural problems which is dominating national debate. We still don't have enough jobs, we are not raising living standards, and we are not producing gains for all segments of society. So this slide demonstrates our first challenge, which is we still have a jobs crisis. Since 2007, we have had new entrants into the labor market, yet the economy is not producing enough jobs to keep pace with that worker growth. Thus, we still have a jobs deficit, not enough demand to employ thousands of workers or put upward pressure on wages. Second, we have a wealth problem. Now, economists always talk about how increasing productivity or output per capita raises living standards. And the good news, which this chart, I'm having technical difficulties with this slide, but the chart shows there's a line graph that the good news is that our economy is actually expanding. There's an upward trajectory on this output per capita. And we've actually, over the, from 1990 to now, output per capita has grown by 36%. So our economy is generating more wealth per person each year from the production of high value goods and services. That's the good news. The problem, which this didn't come out, but is that that economic expansion has not translated to income expansion. In the 1990s, it actually output per person and medium households actually grew together, but that trend has diverged in the 2000s, and it's actually worsened since 2000. So what you can see, at least at the bottom here with the two data points here, is that the rising income from goods and services in the economy, 36%, is resulting in declining incomes for our households, a decline of 4%. And finally, we have an inclusion problem. Economic growth is translating to rising incomes for only the few. The top 1% of all earners have enjoyed a 31% growth in income since the recession, while the bottom 99% of earners have seen essentially no change in their income. And we can even see this unevenness by age. This graphic shows we have a stark youth employment problem. The unemployment rate for teens and young adults aged 20 to 24 who are looking for work, their unemployment rate has climbed to 23% and 13% respectively, while it has just dropped now to 6% from a high of 10% for those 25 and older. So I have three messages I want to impart today. First, is that the U.S. needs to adopt a new model of economic growth, one that responds to the new macro forces that are challenging our ability to build durable, broad-based prosperity. Second, regions will be the vehicle, though, for delivering growth and opportunity because they are the economic engines of the country and because they are the pragmatic, problem-solving centers of the United States. And third, to deliver that high-value growth and opportunity, regions must adapt smarter habits to economic development. And there are exciting regional economic efforts underway, as exemplified by the leaders you're going to hear from on the panel after this talk, as exemplified by many leaders here in the Metro Denver area. The modern economy demands more of such good efforts to bring about better outcomes, ones that traditional strategies often do not yield. So let's go to the first point. How we need a new model of economic growth. Now, as I mentioned earlier, these are tough times. We know that preserving the status quo is not going to cut it anymore if we want to create high-quality jobs and better opportunities for workers. We need a new growth model that goes beyond debt, consumption, real estate, to one focused on the core market assets of the future economy, around innovation, around trade, around human capital, around infrastructure. But as we focus on these assets of the next economy, we also need to adapt to changing times, just like any firm would. Globalization, technology, changing demographics, these market forces are not new, but they are accelerating and taking on new dimensions and challenging what we do to excel in today's global economy in ways that works for workers. And I say challenging because these forces pose both risks and opportunities to our economic goals. Now, on globalization, this chart shows that today, in 2013 anyway, the U.S. has emerged from the recession with more than one-fifth of the world economy, larger than the big nations. So that's positive reflection of economic growth recently. However, over the next 5 years, the BRICS will continue to outpace the U.S. in terms of growth in the share of global GDP. Now, the reason why these emerging markets are growing is because of the growth of the middle class. Today, the bulk of the middle-class consumers are found in the mature markets of the U.S. and the EU, Japan, and our NAFTA partners, which you can see in the blue. But by 2050, the OECD predicts that this picture will change dramatically, with more than half the world's middle-class consumers coming from the 1 billion-plus populations of China and India. And meanwhile, middle-class consumers in the North America, it's going to shrink to 9 to 6%. The risk is greater global competition, but the opportunity is more consumer demand around the world for U.S.-made goods and services. Now, to take advantage of global demand, however, we need to continue to produce cutting-edge products and services. And to do that, we need to embrace technology, which is the next big force, Now, McKinsey estimates that there are 12 disruptive forces today, technologies, 3D printing, renewable energy, robotics, big data, that are really rapidly changing how we work and deliver products across industries, across supply chains, and across the globe, a $33 trillion a year opportunity. However, technology also comes with a risk, a cost. One study found that nearly half of U.S. jobs, particularly routine and low-skill work, are at risk of being replaced by technology. And finally, we have a major demographic shift underway. As our workforce retires, the replacement workforce is projected to be majority persons of color in 20 years. Now, in general, population growth and diversity is a competitive advantage for the United States, with healthy birth rates and we have in-migration. We just need to make sure that this future workforce is equipped with the education and skills they need so they can be part of the future of this economy. So to prosper, then, we must harness what we call the fundamental drivers of economic growth and prosperity. These drivers, interestingly enough, directly match the forces of change. Globalization demands greater focus on the strength of our traded sectors and the extent to which our industry specializations are bringing income into the region through the sales to markets, whether it's in the U.S. or around the world. Technology demands a focus on innovation to ensure that we have a robust innovation ecosystem that enables universities, firms, industries, entrepreneurs to continually create those high-value competitive products. And changing demographics means we need to make sure we have a strong human capital pipeline, an ability to attract, retain, produce skilled workers that allow us to innovate in those traded clusters. So let me quickly walk through each one of these. Why is trade important? First, firms in traded sectors like those in natural gas and energy production, computers, electronics, life sciences to medical devices, high-end business services, they have an outsized impact on the economy. Because these firms trade, they are forced to compete on a national global scale, on price, on value, on niche. So they are more likely to invest in innovation, they're more likely to invest in skills, and therefore, and they're more likely to generate those jobs and support local serving industries. And as a result, traded industries generate higher paying jobs, often support up to 3 local jobs, and generate the overall productivity and wealth of a region. Now, with growing demand, global demand, international trade has additional benefits to jobs and income growth, which is one of our important challenges or opportunities. Even though only 4% of firms right now in the United States export, those international sales generated 8% of all jobs, 30% of all U.S. output in the last 4 years, and further, those international firms and exporting firms, whether in services or manufacturing, pay 20 or 17% more in wages than those firms that did not export at all. Now, we also need to focus on innovation, which is essential to retaining your competitive advantages in key clusters or help you develop new capabilities or new areas of expertise. Now, one measure of innovation is the share of your economy in what we call advanced industries. And I know that folks here in Denver and Colorado understand this term. Advanced industries are manufacturing and services firms that make relatively high investments in R&D and employ a relatively high share of science and engineer workers, like STEM workers, who can then translate that research into commercial applications. Electric vehicle technologies, computer electronics, aerospace, these are all examples of advanced industries. So as you can see from these bar charts, here too advanced industries contribute to growth and wealth creation. As you can see, advanced industries make up 9% of all jobs, 1/5 of GDP, and they contribute vast majority of private and public sector R&D and patents. They also deliver a disproportionate impact on growth in jobs and output. And finally, in an advanced degree, we need a skilled workforce. This chart reinforces that the more you learn, the more you earn. So upskilling all workers is the path to income growth and opportunity. However, if you hold these degrees and work in a STEM occupation, your wage advantage is even higher, even for those with just a high school degree. And the good news is there's lots of STEM jobs in the economy today, 26 million by our count. In fact, 1/5 of all jobs in the economy today require someone with STEM skills, such as a computer specialist or a medical technologist. And half of these STEM jobs require workers who don't need to have an advanced degree. In fact, 50% of jobs are filled with workers with 2-year degrees or less. So the bottom line is traded sectors, innovation, talent in the next economy can lead to those challenges we talked about in growth, wealth, and inclusion. Then there are what we call enablers that further create the conditions for growth. Infrastructure is really about how you organize your physical space to link workers, firms, and suppliers together, whether roads, rail, air, technology, land use, housing, even neighborhood development policies matter. Traffic congestion or high poverty neighborhoods devoid of market access are costs to efficiency and productivity. Governance is the way government is organized and the quality of services actually affect market dynamics and decisions of firms and workers. This also includes the civic capacity of our institutions to address all these market challenges. Together, these 5 highly synergistic drivers create growth, productivity, and opportunity for regions. So any weakness in any one aspect of this affects the performance of others. And I really think this is the framework by which we should think about economic growth strategies. So the second point is that it will be leaders in regions that will deliver this quality growth and opportunity. Now, the first reason is economic. As you can see from this map, the U.S., people treat the U.S. as if it's one monolithic economy. Instead, as Michael Porter once said, the U.S. is made up of a network of metropolitan economies, each with their own distinctive competitive advantages and market opportunities. Now, the U.S. has over 370 metro areas right now. And I want to note that metro areas are labor market sheds, not urban-rural divides. So more than 50% of rural residents actually live inside a metropolitan area, working in regionally significant industries as diverse as agriculture, manufacturing, and services. Now, the starkest evidence of this metro-led economy is that the U.S. actually does not have one economic crisis, but we actually have 370 different economic narratives, reinforcing that macro policies alone will not cut it. We need customized solutions that really reflect the diversity of experiences across the country. And so, for instance, you know, we just talked about the fact that the U.S. as a whole has recovered all the jobs lost since the recession. But if you look at this map and look at all the metro economies, you will see it's a lot more complex than that. About half of all the metro areas today still have not bounced back to their pre-recession jobs numbers. And if you look at specific metro areas, Denver, Portland has recovered their jobs, but Grand Junction, Cleveland, and Detroit metro areas have not. Since 2000, poverty in the nation's largest metro areas actually grew to 15% by 2013, a huge jump from 11% at the beginning of the decade. And here again, Denver, Portland experienced faster growth in their poor, both in their cities and suburbs, while it grew more slowly in Detroit and Cleveland. Now, fortunately, because metropolitan areas are the units of the global economy, they can concentrate the assets needed to address growth and opportunity. And I want to focus on the 100 largest metro areas in particular, because they do power the nation. They sit on just 12% of the nation's land area, but they do produce 75% of the nation's economic output. And they do so because they attract and nurture the very assets the U.S. needs to compete and thrive. So they are the centers of trade, generating 72% of all service exports and moving the bulk of our air cargo. They are the hubs of innovation, home to the vast majority of all of our advanced industries and patents. And they are the magnets of talent, attracting and retaining a disproportionate share of our nation's skilled workforce. And finally, metro areas matter politically. At one time, we may have turned to Washington to help us address these big challenges, but Washington, we know, is gridlocked. Yet American democracy is another U.S. competitive advantage. In the absence of national leadership, we can turn to a vast network of business, civic, political, nonprofit, university, philanthropic actors and partners who can step up, work together, and get stuff done. So gone is what we learned in the high school government textbooks. It is time to flip the pyramid. Economic and social progress will be delivered not top down, but by a pragmatic caucus of leaders in cities and metropolitan areas with their state partners. So the last point is this. With regions now in the driver's seat facing some of the largest economic challenges of our time, it is imperative that regional leaders adopt the right model of economic development to deliver growth and opportunity. Now, this is a provocative statement. In light of today's big structural economic challenges, people always ask me, can local or regional economic development make a difference? The answer, I think, is yes. In fact, in her recent paper for EDA about what is economic development, Professor Feldman made a forceful case that markets alone will not deliver wealth and opportunity for workers. And we see that in the numbers. Instead, the power of economic development is about its intention. The intention to invest in market assets, the intention to invest in the capacities of institutions to unleash the market potential of your firms, of your communities, and of your people in ways that lead to sustained prosperity. That means that business as usual economic development, what we call Starbucks, Stadia, and stealing businesses, or consumption, real estate, and zero-sum business recruitment, is no longer sufficient. It means that we have to acknowledge where the source of economic growth in our region is going to come from, which is primarily from the base of your existing firms and startups, not from the jobs recruited in, which only makes up 2% of job growth. We need a broader economic development toolkit to grow good jobs, to generate income for existing firms and workers, and to ensure that all parts of our community are participating in economic growth. Now, the good news is that metro areas around the country get this economic mandate today, and they have been adopting transformative economic strategies in the wake of the recession. And you're going to hear from some of them in the response panel after this. There are 8 metropolitan areas today that are executing comprehensive business plans for growth, like the powerful 16-county, 4-metro area plan in Northeast Ohio. Another dozen are making transformative investments in 21st century infrastructure and placemaking, like Chicago's first in the nation local infrastructure bank, which is an outgrowth of their metro business plan, or Detroit's Woodward Corridor and Emerging Innovation District in their urban core. Another dozen metro areas have launched regional export and trade strategies like the one in Portland and San Diego. These are all live action, multi-municipal, cross-sector partnerships that are executing transformative strategies toward clear performance outcomes on jobs, on productivity, and on opportunity. So from our collaborations with dozens of metro areas, I've learned a lot from all of these metro areas, and I've now identified what I call the 7 habits of highly effective regional leaders. So let me talk about each one of these 7 habits, because again, I do think there is an emerging understanding towards a new way of doing economic development. So first, it's the obvious. The effective leaders embrace regional markets. They understand that markets are regional. industries agglomerate in regions because of the full access to suppliers, customers, the labor pool, the infrastructure network, the quality of life throughout a metro area. Talent evaluates a location based on the job prospects and market and lifestyle of the entire region before they choose which neighborhood they live in. Neighborhoods, downtowns, suburbs, they are not self-standing markets, but they do have market assets. Like firms, like a port, like an airport, like a community college, or an industrial land that contribute to broader regional economic health. So let's take Chicago as an example. Chicago is the third largest economy in the US. In fact, it's the eighth largest economy in the global economy, thanks to an economy that's evolved from being just manufacturing to one that's much more diverse portfolio with some now headquarter companies. Now, but too often, here, let me just talk through this. That economy right now is, not surprising, spread across three states, 14 counties, 554 municipalities. So too often you find a region where the central city, the counties, and the smaller jurisdictions each have their own economic development plans and a singular focus to increase their own tax base. The result is a competition for jobs, for workers, and even convention centers and amenities that use taxpayer funds to just simply shift growth around a region versus growing the regional economic pie. Now, to Chicago's credit, they have worked hard to overcome their jurisdictional fragmentation so they can grow together. They've consolidated their two MPOs into one regional transportation planning agency. They consolidated the separate Chicago and Cook County workforce investment boards into one workforce effort. And just earlier this week, Mayor Rahm Emanuel and his county peers announced an unprecedented seven-county collaboration to help each other work with each of their own businesses grow through exports versus poaching firms from each other. In this day and age, you have to collaborate locally if you want to compete globally. Second, effective leaders compete on value, not cost. The goal of economic development is to create the conditions for economic growth that leads to greater wealth and income for firms, for people, and for communities. To start, that means you need to focus on value creation, not cost reduction. The economy needs to constantly produce high-value goods and services that increases the chances to raise living standards. It's really hard to be inclusive if your economy is not expanding. To do that, leaders must boost the total value of their location, not just reducing the cost of one transaction. Globally, we know that competing on cost alone is a race to the bottom when the rest of the world is trying to move up the value chain. But within the US, we tend to forget this edict, with traditional economic development spending probably far too much time trying to create packages that reduce the price of a location package when what we need is more of the former focus on your assets. Now, studies by the Boston Consulting Group and others have found that more and more firms are making location decisions or even reshoring decisions based on indicators such as access to skilled labor, access to dense supply chains, proximity to customers, good transportation network. Again, it's the total value of a location, not its low price. We could talk to folks in California about that, that attracts and retains firms. Third, the effective leaders prioritize people, not just profits. In fact, we need people to make profits. And in today's knowledge economy, machines and equipment alone cannot replace the unique insights, the interactions, and the creativity of people. But in recent decades, firms have prized technology over people, physical capital over human capital, and public solutions to education and skills gaps over private sector solutions. In fact, while workforce training programs have become more demand-driven, it's still often public-led. However, firms are beginning to step in and reclaim the importance of skills, and economic development leaders should help them take a more active responsibility in skilling up our existing and next generation of workers. And these include designing curriculum with on-site learning opportunities for career high schools or community colleges. It means increasing their own investments for training of their own workers, as well as doing skills-based hiring to expand the eligible applicant pool for their positions. and it means more apprenticeship opportunities, which, while has been declining in the U.S., has now actually taken a lot more interest in recent years. Particularly, the German-style apprenticeship program is now beginning to take hold here in the United States. As a reminder, when women entered the labor force, we saw notable gains in U.S. productivity and median household incomes. Now we need to put a concerted effort to bring younger, more diverse workers into the labor market. The best way to ensure relevant training to real jobs is not just demand-driven, but employer-led skills initiatives. Fourth, effective leaders invest in market assets. They don't just recruit them. As I mentioned earlier, leaders must invest in the market drivers of economic growth that creates the stickiness for firms to stay or expand in a region. So on the left is a story about Albany. Like many smaller, mid-sized markets, they were having trouble growing jobs from just business recruitment. They were not winning any deals or getting meaningful moves. So they decided to focus on their inherent assets, a university with an emerging capability in nanoscience and engineering, and a history of manufacturing and semiconductor companies in the region like IBM. The result is Albany Nanotech, now a world-class industry-driven R&D and commercialization facility that has garnered the interest of IBM, Symantec, and GlobalFoundries, which has now built a $4.6 billion semiconductor facility on-site. It has spawned new startups and now houses a STEM high school inside one of these new lab buildings at the university. Meanwhile, the chart on the right reflects a real business attraction numbers from a region that we have been working with. And I'm going to let that region remain anonymous. Now, regional economic development entities often track and report out in big forums the number of firms and jobs they have recruited into their market. In this case, more than 23,000 jobs. And as you can see in the number with the net, the activity is a success because it created net new jobs in the region. Then we looked at what the nature of the jobs that came in and out. And what we found is the region's recruitment strategy was actually attracting low productivity firms while it was losing high productivity jobs. This region's economic development strategy was contributing to the overall decline in the region's competitiveness by attracting a lower value mix of industries into the market while ignoring the needs of existing high value firms and industries, which ultimately left. The lesson from Albany is this: retention, expansion, attraction, startup, skills development, they can all happen as a result of proactive alignment of your assets that leads to organic growth versus ad hoc reactive strategies that may not result in net gain to the region's broader path to prosperity. Fifth, effective leaders invest in trade, not consumption. I read recently an economist describe that the real economy is one in which real companies, individuals, and governments buy and sell real products for real prices. Trade, that's what that is. Trade is how you create value-added growth and opportunity, and we've talked about the importance of trade and trade sectors. Yet the problem is, according to Nobel laureate Michael Spence, as you can see on the left, in the last two decades, only 2% of net new job growth in the United States came from our traded sectors, because we were spent focusing on debt, consumption, real estate, and other local serving industries. Regional economic leaders need to remember that global trade and your unique clusters are the drivers of economic growth. Housing, retail, and entertainment, they still matter, but they follow. Sixth habit, effective leaders build networks, not go it alone. Now, we live in a network economy today. Gone is the hierarchical leadership chart on the left, where the mayor sits on top and leaders line up behind them. Gone is the entrepreneur who sits in a garage by his or herself inventing products by themselves. Today, all new ventures, new solutions, systemic changes come through complex networks and partnerships that reflect the hyper-integrated nature of the economy. In short, economic development is ultimately about capacity. It is about the capacity of multiple institutions and actors to come together and forge new and changing partnerships in ways that improves and aligns all of your community's assets to produce prosperity. And that capacity needs to be nimble and it needs to be ongoing to produce lasting prosperity. And finally, effective leaders track long-term outcomes, not just short-term tactics. I know there's a lot of text here, but let me describe this. On the left is what we would consider is what matters. The ultimate objective is for economic development is to boost the regional economic assets and capacities in your community in that ways that would lead to lasting growth and prosperity for all. So the indicators that reflect that goal, job growth, output growth, income growth, and increasing labor force participation by age, race, ethnicity. On the right could be construed as traditional metrics. This honestly is something I downloaded from an IEDC-sponsored report on the metrics for high-performing economic development. It was the title of the report, and I was curious what the report would say. That quote is a direct quote in the report. High-performance economic development is the dedicated pursuit of any objective, no matter what the current objective may be, coupled with measured progress along the way. And then the report listed 40 metrics for success, mostly in response to site selectors. Unique website visits, number of conversations with firms about their location decisions, the number of jobs created per week. Now imagine those metrics being adopted for every economic development officer in every municipality or county in a region. What you measure is what you get. Which outcome do you want for your efforts? Okay, so let me close with a quote from the man I've been plagiarizing, which is Stephen Covey. Whoops. These seven habits I've outlined today are not an abstract concept. They're actually things I have pulled and witnessed from watching regional leaders across the country, from leaders who are trying to break from the past and rise to the economic imperative of today. While there is still room for traditional economic development tactics, we need to make these good habits and behaviors more the norm. And if we begin with the end in mind, we can build long-term growth and opportunity in not just each of our communities, but for the nation as a whole. That is the Metropolitan Revolution. Thank you.